Hello, everyone. Thank you, Tina, for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me here to share with you some of the recent findings about the genetics of Central Asian populations and what we can learn from ancient DNA to understand their evolutionary history. So when I start talking about Central Asia, I like to take a step back because I want to introduce a region that's very rich and is actually very close to my heart. When we think about Central Asia, or at least when I think about it, I think about such aspects about human history and human behavior, such as the development of mobile pastoralism that happened at the transition from the Bronze Age to the Iron Age. We can think of various networks, such as the networks of the Silk Roads that connected the East and the West, and also in the more recent times, spread of religions, such as Islam, that is here represented by one of the beautiful Central Asian oases cities with their architecture. The region itself is actually quite diverse with regards to the ecological zones that are presented. So you can see here that there are in the north Kazakh steppes and forests. In the middle, you can see Central Asian deserts. There are mountainous regions. There are Persian deserts and forests. And it is important for our understanding of the selection that has operated in the region because we have people that are living in very different ecological zones and have likely experienced differences in their in natural selection. What is known currently is that there are many diverse ethnic groups and languages that are presented, and here you can see in many colors are the different examples of the languages and the groups that are spoken in the languages that are spoken and groups that live in the region. And what is actually interesting is that there's a lot of mixture of the various colors that represent the ethnic groups, which is likely due to the more recent events such as the forced movement of people during the Soviet time. What we know is that Central Asia was and is still a migration corridor for human species. So going back to what has been talked by Diendo and Janet, we know that Neanderthals and Denisovans have moved and have existed in the region. But even in more recent times, we see a lot of migration and human interactions that have shaped the genetics of people today. And in my research and the research of my group, we're interested in disentangling this rich tapestry that comes from using evidence from genetics, archaeology, historical records, linguistics to understand how the Central Asian genomes came to be and what has shaped their diversity through time. This PCA has been shown multiple times, so just to reiterate, we see principal components that are summarizing the most extreme axes of human variation. In this case, all individuals are represented by a dot, and the PC principal components 1 and 2 are separating geography. And what we know about Eurasia is that there are multiple clines that are associated with ecological zones. In this case, we see the forest tundra cline, that is the northernmost cline, as well as the steppe forest cline and the southern steppe clines. And there are kind of connecting the two regions, such as the Europe, the Caucasus, and the Near East, which can be shown on the left, as well as the Northeast Asia and Southeast Asian populations that are shown on the right. And when we focus on the modern populations of Central Asia, they cluster along what is known as the southern steppe cline. And here we can see examples of modern-day Kazakhs, Tajik, Uyghur, Turkmen, Uzbek, and other groups of Central Asia. And this is not the only representation that can help us understand the diversity of the genomes if we look at what is known as the admixture analysis, where every population gets its own color. The Central Asians are represented as a mixture of the ancestry sources of East Asia, that is here shown in red, and Europe, that's shown in yellow, then going to green and higher levels of clustering. But we see mixtures of these ancestries that are presented in various populations. If we look at the modern data from the modern Kazakh individuals, for instance, we can see that here these numbers are FSG, and it tells us how different the populations are from each other. So the modern day Kazakh populations are most closely related to other Turkic groups, such as the Uyghur, the Uzbek, but are more distant to other Siberian groups, such as the Enganasan, the Siberians, and also populations like Tajik. So the question that I have is, what can we learn about the history of the region using ancient DNA? And as has been shown before, many times the number of ancient DNA individuals published has increased dramatically in the last years. However, there still exists a difference in how the regions are represented. So as has been shown by Johannes, we know a lot about the history of Western Eurasia and specifically Europe. For many reasons, there are many labs that are in Europe and in North America, and also there are many different rules and regulations that exist with regards to what genomes can be studied and what countries are open to it and what communities are open to it or not. And when we look at other regions of the world, there are some that remain understudied, such as Central Asia, but also I would say the majority of the world outside of Europe remains understudied when we think about ancient DNA. And I will briefly give an overview of the various changes that happened during the going from very periods from back in time to present time, and I will try to connect them to potential selective pressures that we can think of as we try to go into analysis of natural selection. So going back to Enneolithic and Neolithic, so this would be around 5,000 to 6,000 years ago. Here we see some of the earliest individuals. These are, some of them are hunter-gatherers. Some of them are also associated with possible horse domestication, such as the Bowtie culture. And they're known as having this ancestry profile, which is called the ancient North Eurasian ancestry. Also during this time, we see connections between some of the farming communities that existed around the Black Sea with some of the more western outskirts of the steppe populations where we see these genetic contacts. Going more closer in time in the Bronze Age, we start seeing other events that are occurring in the Central Asian steppes, but also in southern Central Asia. It's a time of migrations. For instance, here, show an image from a publication that looked at the migration of the Yamnaya group that has spread around to the Western and Eastern Eurasia. We know definitely there was horse domestication during the Bronze Age. Also, during this time, we see the development of metallurgical networks and networks of production. This is something that I was involved in. And we see, again, further contacts between the steppe populations with also these more southern farming communities, such as those of the Bactria-Margiana archaeological complex. As we go into the Iron Age, this time period is associated with the Scythians. They are known for mobile pastoralism, so the populations that were pastoral already in the Bronze Age, or they were more semi-nomadic or in some cases sedentary, during the Iron Age they become fully mobile nomads, and this is the invention that didn't happen before. We see horse riding. Horses were used before, but people start riding horses in the Iron Age and potentially end of the Bronze Age. This is also a time when we see the development of nomadic kingdoms. There's social stratification based on the types of burials that are found in the Iron Age, and the ancestry of the people becomes mixed. So the ancestries that existed in the Bronze Age, such as the Western steppe ancestry, the Eastern steppe pastoralist ancestry, and the ancestries of the people who lived in the Southern Central Asia become mixed, less, very likely due to the fact that the people are mobile and pastoral, so they're able to move a lot and they're able to interact with each other. Even going further, closer in time, in the early medieval period, it's a time of the migration period, it's time of the long-distance relatedness, and the Silk Roads start developing, or they start developing a bit early, but they are seen as reaching their height during this time. And here we can see that there are already these long-distance connections between populations that are occupying very different parts of the world, such as the Western Eurasia, Eastern Eurasia, and we see a lot of genetic, long-distance genetic interactions. So going into the population history of Central Asia through time, what can we learn about the selection in the region using ancient DNA? So we know that going from different time periods that the region has experienced different cultural transformation, migration, admixture, and developments such as mobile pastoralism, can we glean something using ancient DNA? And here, what is really revolutionary about ancient DNA is that it allows us to study selection in a different way, which was not possible before. It allows us to distinguish between selection on standing variation versus novel mutations. So looking at modern populations, we can only see the states of people the way they are now. If we are able to go in the past, we can see if a mutation is really new or if it was already in the standing variation and was selected for because of a new environmental pressure. What's important is that modern populations are admixed. They represent mixtures of previously isolated populations. So if you look at, and it will be most of the modern populations living now, and even the populations that we think of as being somewhat homogeneous, like the modern native English, represent a mixture of previously isolated early Neolithic farmers, the Western European hunter-gatherers, as well as the Yamnaya steppe pastoralists. So without being able to understand the mixture and the how people admix through time, it is hard to understand their selection. Modern populations represent genetic states after natural selection took place. So if we are able to look at the ancestry changes through time and looking from the past to current time period, we can track how different alleles and how different genes change when a certain advantageous variant, for instance, appears. It increases in frequency if it is under selection, and after many generations, it is either reaching fixation or is staying at a higher frequency if it is truly an advantageous variant. And ancient genomes can show natural selection in action. This is something that was not possible before, but what is great is that we can track these changes that occurred in our evolutionary history, such as we know if there was an aridification of a climate, we know if there was another climatic change that could have had an effect on the genome, or if there was a temperature change. And we can look at things like changes of life ways and mobility to try to connect them to how genomes are changing through time. We also know that at different time points, different pathogens arise and intensify during our evolutionary history. And by being able to use these time-stamped genomes, we can actually track the various genes or various variants, how they change through time. And in our understanding of natural selection, actually, the Central Asian region also remains understudied. Here is a map of various studies that have looked at selection globally and have identified various genes and various pathways as being under selection, such as selection for height, skin color, high altitude adaptation, adaptation to disease, and other environmental and cultural factors. And still, there are many regions of the world that remain not as understood with regards to their selective of their history of natural selection. And now I'll go through some examples of adaptation that we know in Central Asian populations, but we only know them from the modern populations. So one of these examples is skin color adaptation. It's one of the very classic examples of human adaptation. We know that the signals of selection, and we know that selection for skin color adaptation is really associated with the amount of UV radiation that a population is exposed to. For instance, along the equator, we know that there are the highest amounts of UV radiation, and that's where the individuals living in those regions have the darkest skin color in order to adapt to the high UV radiation. And as we move out of the equator, the skin color adaptation relaxes, so then we see the development of lighter skin color. And in Western Eurasia, especially in Europe, there has been a lot of work looking at skin color adaptation, and many different genes and regions have been identified. The signals of selection in Central Asian populations are somewhat similar to what we see in Western Eurasia, such as in genes like SLC24A5, OCA2, BCN2, and others. However, what is still not well understood is how can we differentiate the outcomes of the West Eurasian admixture with potential selection in the region that happens post-admixture. So as I've shown before, the Central Asian individuals represent this mixture of the ancestries of the Western Eurasia as well as the Eastern Eurasia. And one of the questions that we have is, can we actually differentiate the impact of the admixture from what happens potentially later in time? Another very classic questions in the literature, or very anthropological questions, is high altitude adaptation. This is actually what was my PhD work was on high altitude adaptation, but in the Andes. However, it's not only in the Andes where people live at high altitude. There are populations in Central Asia that also occupied high altitude areas, such as the Tajik and the Kyrgyz people who live on the Pamir Plateau. And although the populations are quite small, the population sizes are quite small of the people who live at high altitude in Central Asia, there's still some isolated villages that are at above 4,000 meters above sea level, which is considered very high altitude. And although there hasn't been as much research done on this topic, we know that there was adaptation related to increased UV radiation, because at high altitude, we are exposed to higher UV from the atmosphere being not being thinner. And we know that there was adaptation for cardiovascular system genes that are associated with being able to potentially pump more blood with that is moving more oxygen. However, no adaptation has been identified in genes like EPAS1 and EGLN1, which are these very canonical high-altitude genes that are under selection in Tibetans and potentially also in Indians. At least EGLN1 is also under selection in Indians. And genes associated with high-altitude pulmonary hypertension have been found in the Kyrgyz high-altitude populations that were associated with both protection, but also the etiology of this condition. And I'd like to point out here is that a lot of these studies were done on a very small sample size, and still a lot remains, I think, unknown. If we go to another phenotype that is that I find interesting is a dietary adaptation. So there were studies that were looking at the genetic adaptation to farming. In this case, we look at more southern Central Asian populations, such as the Tajiks, who are known for being more sedentary and who are involved in farming. And a few studies have shown that they have a different variant of an enzyme called arylamide and acetyltransferase 2 or NAT2 that is involved with slow acetylation variants of this enzyme. And these types of variants are also found in other groups that have a plant-based diet. And they found these variants when they were comparing the more sedentary agricultural Tajik population with more pastoral Kyrgyz population. So here we see this evidence for metabolic adaptation to diet and farming. The last very known phenotype that is associated with dietary change and cultural change in humans is lactase persistence, which is the ability to digest milk. It has undergone selection in modern Europeans, as well as pastoral populations of Africa and the Middle East. And we know that it arose, one of the variants that is known in modern Europeans arose in steppe pastoralists. However, when we look at the modern Central Asian populations, we don't see high levels of lactase persistence. So this is an example of what we call cultural adaptation. So this is adaptation by fermentation. So in a lot of Central Asian populations, milk is not consumed in its raw form, but it is fermented into kefir, ayran, yogurt, and this is a way that it is consumed. It's also possible that there's the impact of the microbiome. Lastly, I would like to, my second to last slide, I'd like to highlight again that the Central Asians are really underrepresented in GWAS catalogs, or what are known as the genome-wide association study catalogs, that are primarily focused on individuals of European ancestry. If we look at the GWAS numbers here, more than 80% of GWAS studies have been done in modern Europeans. And if we then zoom into the East Asians and the Asian populations, there are actually zero GWAS associations that we know from Central Asian populations. And this is something that I'm interested in doing. And with collaboration with my colleagues in Kazakhstan, we are trying to sequence more modern Central Asians to better understand their genetic history and how it has changed through time by connecting it to the ancient genetic history. And with that, I'd like to thank you for being here, and thank you various collaborators and institutions where I'm affiliated.